Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Toby Man, written by Dick King-Smith and read by Nigel Lambert.
Chapter 1. Matilda. At the side of a muddy country road, a small footpad stood behind a large tree. The year was 1730. The night was wet and windy, and the small footpad was shivering, partly with cold, for his clothes were thin and ragged, and partly with excitement, for he was bent on highway robbery for the very first time in his life. Suddenly, he heard the sound of footsteps squelching through the mud, and peeping round the tree, saw the bent figure of an old woman approaching, supporting herself on a rough staff. With pounding heart, the small footpad stepped into the road and cried, in as gruff a voice as he could muster, "Stand and deliver!" Tod Golightly came from a long line of robbers. His mother's family were sheep stealers, a high-risk profession. More than one of them had dangled from a rope. But his father's people preferred to keep their feet more firmly on the ground. They were footpads to a man, working the Toby, thieves' slang for the road, beside which they lay in wait to rob travellers. Robbery on foot was known as low Toby, and Tod's father had advised him as to the conduct of it.
"Pick on the easy ones, son," he told Tod. "Go for the defenceless wayfarer. No sense in running risks. Never tackle a man on horseback. He'll ride you down. And as for carriages and coaches, steer clear of them. Holding up a coach is work for a mounted man, what we call High Toby. Like that there Richard Turpin up York way, with his fine black mare and his brace of pistols. 'Tis low Toby for us footpads. No need for any of that stand and deliver nonsense. Just sneak in quick and quiet and away with whatever you can lay your hands on."
"But, father," said Tod, "aren't you supposed to say your money or your life?"
"Save your breath," was the reply. "Show him your knife. That'll do it."
That was the last advice the footpad gave his son, for one very dark night, shortly afterwards, he sneaked in quick and quiet and showed his knife to a traveller and, for the first and last time in his life, found himself staring into the mouth of a blunderbuss.
"Ar me,"
said Tod's mother, drying her tears on her kerchief of fine Irish lace that her late husband had stolen from a passing peddler.
"He's gone, my Toby man. He did his poor best for us. Now 'tis up to you to take his place, Tod, and carry on the family tradition. The good name of Golightly is in your hands."
As soon as Tod had uttered the words, "Stand and deliver," he remembered that his father had advised him against such speeches. It didn't matter, however, since the old woman plodded on past him without taking the slightest notice. Tod ran after her and planted himself in her way. Louder now, he cried again,
"Stand and deliver!"
The old lady stopped and leant on her staff. She stared at Tod, cupping one scrawny hand around her ear.
"Stand in the river?" she said. "'Twould make no odds if I did, young man. I be soaked to the skin as 'tis."
Tod brandished his knife in her face. It wasn't a real knife, but he'd carved it from a piece of wood and painted the tip of it red to make it appear bloodstained.
"Your money or your life?" he shouted. "A funny sort of knife," said the old woman. "I should just think it is. Now stop thy games, there's a good boy, and stand aside."
"But I'm a footpad," said Tod.
"I can't help it if your foot's bad," said the crone angrily. "Thee'll have more than one bad foot if thee doesn't get out of my way."
And when Tod did not move, she raised her staff and brought the butt of it down on his toes. As he hopped about in pain, she pushed past him, and, caught off balance, the small footpad toppled and fell with a splash into the roadside ditch.
"Hee-haw! Hee-haw! Hee-haw!"
brayed a loud, harsh voice above him, and struggling to his feet, waterlogged, mud-covered, and empty-handed, Tod saw a long-eared grey head sticking over the top of the hedge.
"Call yourself a Toby Man," said the donkey. "I know what I'd call you."
"What?" said Tod wetly.
"I'd call you a silly ass."
What happened next was, though he could not know it, to decide the whole course of Tod Golightly's future. First, to fail miserably in an attempted robbery, then to be ducked in a dirty ditch, and finally to be guffawed at by a donkey, would have put most people off a life on the Toby. Most people, indeed, would have reacted angrily, cursing at fortune, swearing at the old woman, throwing stones at the animal, or perhaps they would have given way before the sheer unfairness of life, and have put their heads in their hands and wept. Indeed, for a moment, Tod felt like having a good cry. But then, suddenly, as he fished his wooden knife from the water, the absurdity of it all struck him, and he began to laugh. He laughed and laughed like a mad thing, standing knee-deep in the ditch while the donkey stared at him with an expression of surprise on its mild, hairy face.
"Oh, Lord o' mussy," gasped Tod. "A silly ass I may be, but you ain't. I'm grateful to you, my friend, that I am."
"What for?" said the donkey.
"Why, for making me see the funny side of my first robbery. Now I can go home happy, thanks to you. Even though I've stolen nothing."
"You still could," said the donkey.
Tod climbed out of the ditch and peered up and down the dusky road, but he could see no one, nor hear the sounds of anyone approaching.
"'Tis too late," he said. "No wayfarers will come now. They're all abed. There's nothing for me to steal."
"Yes, there is," said the donkey. "Steal me."
"Steal you?" cried Tod. "But why do you want to be stolen? Aren't you happy as you are?"
"I am not," said the donkey. "I'm either put to a cart and made to pull loads so weighty as to almost break my heart, or ridden by a man so heavy as almost to break my back, who beats me for going too slow or for stopping when I can go no further. And I get little to eat, save thistles. Therefore I'm not happy. You are looking for something to steal. I am looking for someone to steal me. There is no problem."
"Well, there is one," said Tod. "What if I am caught? They hang folk for sheep stealing, so for donkey stealing, I should think that I'd be hung, drawn and quartered."
"But," said the donkey, "if you're not caught, think what you will gain. Such a lightweight would be a pleasure for me to carry all day long. Not for you the poor rewards of a footpad. With me as your steed, you could try your luck on the high, Toby."
"I could," said Tod.
"I could," he thought. "I'll do it," he thought.
"I'll do it," he said.
"Then listen to me, young master," said the donkey. "What do they call you, by the way?"
Tod,
said the small footpad through chattering teeth, for he was very chilled from his soaking.
"I am Matilda," said the donkey, "and I am old enough to be your mother. You have a mother, I presume?"
Yes.
"Then get you home to her, so that she may put dry clothes on your outside and some good hot broth in your inside, or else you'll have no need to worry about being hung, drawn and quartered. You'll catch your death of cold instead. Off with you now."
"But what about you, Matilda?" said Tod. "Aren't you coming? Where's the gate? I'll let you out."
"Make haste slowly," said Matilda. "That's my motto. First you must be dry and fed and rested. Then you must bid farewell to your mother. Tell her that you are off to seek your fortune. Tell her You'll return one day laden with gold coins and jewels and gems and pearls and precious stones enough for a king's ransom. Then come back. I will be waiting at dawn. Meow.
Chapter 2. Digby. Dawn was breaking as Tod made his way back to the donkey's field. He was fed and rested, and now much better clothed. His mother had fitted him out with the best of his late father's spoils. A tricorn hat, a heavy fustian overcoat, and a pair of stout boots. The coat reached almost to Tod's ankles, but the hat gave him a jaunty air as he strode along, awkwardly, for the top boots were so much too large that he'd had to stuff rags into their toes. He was so excited at the prospect before him that he didn't feel in the least sad at leaving his mother. "All this talk of what you will bring me," she had said sadly. "How do you expect me to believe that? Why, your poor father," and she shed a few more tears into the Irish lace, "was a hard-working footpad all his life, and yet this kerchief was one of the few things of any value that he ever managed to steal. Mostly it was paltry stuff, half a dozen eggs, or a hen from a goodwife on her way to market, or a few coins from some old drunkard reeling home from the tavern. How could a lad like you bring me gold and jewellery, as you say you will? To do that, you must rob the stagecoaches and the carriages of the gentry."
"But that's what I aim to do, Mother," cried Tod. "Father may have been only a footpad, but I am going to be a highwayman."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.